almost the whole day, and we already had three discussions made. So the last one will be the dramaturgy of gender performance. So I'm very happy to be invited in this forum and to share with these three my favorite artists. I'm still waiting for some other people there.
Yeah.
The smokers.
So actually the session will be part from the experience of these three artists in working on their projects that related to how to perform gender. So in like a bit simplistic way, it's kind of like there are the tendency or like for the idea to construct also how artists, like in this case in performing art, usually they use the body and how the body actually already form the interpretation of gender. So there are some cases here that will be presented going to the idea of how artists deconstructing the gender characteristic of the bodies. Is it the project usually to against this, the stereotype, or to use the stereotypical language to perform critical voice in the relation of gender? And also, when I discussed with them before we started this discussion, it's quite interesting later on to see how the narratives of the subjects, how the artist can form an autobiographical stories through the bodies and performances. We have three presenters here. So I will start with O'Neill Tasman. She's in my left hand. O'Neill Tasman is a young choreographer whose practice is strongly rooted in Japanese tradition, especially from his hometown in Banyumas. Tasman mainly uses the Banyumas traditional dance from Lengger to create his work. He's especially drawn to Lengger Lanang, the male dancer, which is a variation of the form featuring female dancers dressing up as women to perform for its play on gender identity. O'Neill graduated from the Indonesian Institute of the Art Surakarta in 2013. He has choreographed works such Rohong, Angguan, Mantra, Barangan, Lengger Laut, Penantian Daria, The Wake of Daria, and the latest one, Stenggu. He also has collaborated with local and international artists such as Min Wong, Daniel Kong, Hanafi Muhammad, and Gary Nugroho. So for the first page, I give the microphone to O'Neill, please.
Selamat sore. Perkenalkan nama saya Niel Tasman. Saya lahir di Banyumas 28 tahun yang lalu. Terus maaf saya berbahasa Indonesia.
Nah.
Oke. Okay. Sekarang saya lulusan ISI tahun 2014. Terus saya sekarang sedang melanjutkan studi master saya di Institut Seni Indonesia Surakarta tahun ini. Okay. Sebelumnya, minat saya adalah gagasan utama saya adalah lengger. Lengger adalah tradisi dari Banyumas, bagaimana laki-laki yang memerankan perempuan di atas panggung dan mempresentasikan perempuan pada saat menari. Beberapa karya yang sudah saya hasilkan antara lain ada Rohong tahun 2010, terus ada Mantra di tahun 2012 ada lengger barangan tahun 2013 dan juga ada penantian dari yang tahun 2015 serta Nozihi Ore tahun 2016 Stand Go-Go tahun 2017 dan yang terakhir ada karya Cakrata tahun 2018. Mengapa lengger yang saya pilih karena dari kecil saya hidup di lingkungan kesenian lengger, jadi ketika saya lahir saya buka mata ya lengger yang selalu ada di sekeliling saya pada waktu itu. Jadi saya lengger adalah sebagai bahasa ibu saya pada waktu kecil dan sampai sekarang itu. Sampai sekarang saya memahami dan mendalami apa itu lengger. Ini adalah foto pertunjukan lengger yang ada di Banyumas. Sedikit cerita tentang lengger adalah ekspresi kesenian pinggiran di mana kita dianggap sebagai kaum minoritas atau marginal, jadi di pinggiran di mana posisi kita jauh dari hal yang bersifat adiluhung atau bersifat seperti keraton. Jadi lengger mempunyai sikap resisten terhadap kesenian yang bernilai adiluhung gitu. Terus selanjutnya bahasa yang saya gunakan dalam saya berkarya adalah bahasa lengger. Jadi lengger menjadi bahasa saya untuk mengungkapkan gagasan saya pada setiap karya-karya saya yang saya hasilkan gitu. Terus yang paling spesial adalah ketika saya punya pengalaman yang sangat panjang dengan sosok lengger lanang yang bernama Daria yang sudah meninggal sekitar 2 bulan, tidak 4 bulan yang lalu. Bagaimana saya memahami secara tubuh Daria dari ketubuhan Daria serta sosial dan masyarakatnya Daria. Dari performa tubuh Daria, saya banyak sekali mengamati dan memahami dan juga mendapatkan beberapa nilai yang bisa saya dapatkan dari saya mengamati tubuh Daria. Selain itu, saya juga mengamati bagaimana Daria bersosial dan berinteraksi dengan masyarakat gitu. Terus selanjutnya adalah proses kreatif saya. Yang pertama, saya melakukan riset kepada para ahli lengger yang ada di Banyumas. Selain itu juga saya riset kepada masyarakat di lingkungan lengger juga gitu. Terus yang selanjutnya adalah incubation atau discussion ideas with the team. Saya melakukan proses studio dengan para penari, dengan musik, dengan musician, dengan lighting designer untuk membongkar atau melakukan eksplorasi dengan gagasan yang saya hadirkan. Di proses studio saya, pastinya saya mendapatkan banyak sekali kendala bagaimana saya bertemu dengan penari yang mungkin tidak banyak tahu mengenai lengger gitu. Jadi saya menggunakan tubuh laki-laki dan juga perempuan dalam saya membongkar ide tentang gagasan lengger itu sendiri gitu. Jadi justru itu adalah tantangan bagi saya, bagaimana saya mentransfer pengalaman tubuh saya dengan para penari, di mana para penari itu tidak banyak mengerti apa itu lengger gitu. Di situ terdapat kendala karena saya harus banyak sekali menemukan pemahaman-pemahaman lain yang dapat ditransfer kepada tubuh-tubuh penari gitu. Sehingga para penari punya interpretasi sendiri terhadap tubuh daya atau lengger yang ingin saya hadirkan gitu. Terus setelah melakukan proses studio, di sini saya menerapkan dramaturgi dengan cara presentasi dengan banyak orang atau melakukan work in progress, dan juga saya mengirimkan video saya untuk saya mendapatkan evaluasi seperti itu. Dari banyaknya masukan dari penonton, dari orang-orang yang menurut saya menjadi penasihat saya, salah satunya adalah Pak Salmugianto dan juga ada Akorens dari Belgia, dia juga sebagai salah satu penasihat artistik saya. Itu menjadi cara saya melibatkan kerja dramaturgi di sini. Terus selanjutnya ini adalah foto pada waktu saya riset di Banyumas. Yang ini adalah Ibu Daria yang sudah meninggal 4 bulan yang lalu. Dan yang satu ini respon dari yang lain menjadi salah satu respon dari saya juga. Terus selanjutnya ini karya saya barengan dari hasil riset saya. Terus ini karya perantian dari ya. Selanjutnya perantian dari lagi ada lengger laut. Ya, dari beberapa karya tersebut akhirnya saya menemukan statement tentang bercampurnya tubuh maskulin dan juga feminin di dalam satu tubuh, yaitu kalau di Jawa kita menamakannya Nyawiji gitu. Dari Nyawiji itu akhirnya setelah saya melahirkan karya yang gelap, saya belum tahu apa itu yang namanya gender gitu. Ketika saya menemukan konsep Nyawiji di tubuh Daria atau di tubuh Lengger itu, akhirnya mau tidak mau saya harus memahami apa itu gender gitu. Dari situ berkembang menjadi karya Nosi di Oring gitu. Di sini saya melakukan banyak sekali dialog dengan penari gitu, melakukan banyak diskusi dengan semua tim untuk membongkar atau benar-benar mendalami karakter maskulin dan feminin atau yang disebut Nyawiji pada satu tubuh itu. Terus ini pentas di Cafe Brussel, dan kita berpengalaman di Jerman pada waktu festival lokal ya. Terus selanjutnya ada video.
Thank you.
di mana saya salah satu grup yang wakil Indonesia di event Biru Pada Festival gitu. Ini menjadi perspektif saya bagaimana karya saya dari LinkedIn bisa dihubungkan dengan isu-isu yang sensitif atau apa itu, di mana ketika Indonesia sedang sedang gaduhnya tentang isu-isu LGBT, bahkan sampai booming di Solo, tapi saya justru mempetaskan karya saya untuk mewakili Indonesia di Eropa gitu. Terus yang terakhir adalah karya Cabelaka yang baru pentas di Kalidara pada satu bulan yang lalu, juga sama dari perkembangan dari OCDOE. Saya lebih jelas lagi untuk membuat set yang baru tentang lagi adalah jenis ketiga gitu. Kira-kira seperti itu, dan terima kasih selamat sore.
Thank you Elmil for the presentation. I think there is one section that not have been translated from what I saw here. I know it's quite difficult because he speaks quite fast and you have to translate it simultaneously. So the thing that I think important and interested is his statement that saying for when he started to be a dancer, he didn't really take so much consideration into the notion of gender. Just when he started to do the project about Langer and he did some research about Langer, then he started to learn also the notion of gender. I think then this also leads him to the next steps of how he investigate the blur notions of the characteristic of the body between the femininity and masculinity. I thank you so much, O'Neill, and the second presenter will be Tamara Pertamina. So I invite her to come on the stage here, Tamara. So I think Tamara will present very quite different case with O'Neill, because O'Neill really depart from his experience with traditional art. This is part of his way of being raised during childhood, and also this brought him to continuous explorations, experiments on how the tradition can be renewed or reinterpreted all the time in the new context. Tamara will present mostly from kind of like everyday life, performativity from being activist and also artist.
Where is your bio?
So Tamara is an Indonesian artist born in Tasikmalaya in 1989. In 2006, Tamara joined and worked with transgender community, turning the busking and sex work for a living. In 2008, Tamara moved to Yogyakarta. Until now, Tamara was introduced to the world of art in 2012 when her involvement in art project entitled Matchik Project, which was curated by Grisombo, was presented during the first Jogja Biennale Equatoria. Tamara's works explore gender and sexuality issues, transgender history in Indonesia, religion, and humanity. In 2013, she developed the project We Are Human and worked with individuals from various backgrounds to survey sexual orientations, gender expression, equality, and problems that occur in the society. So please, Tamara.
Hello, selamat sore semuanya. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Tadi sudah disampaikan sama Mbak Alia kalau nama saya Tamara Pertamina. Tapi sebenarnya saya memperkenalkan nama kecil saya dulu. Dulu kecil saya dikasih nama Adanulo, kalau kamu belum merasa kan? Ada Mulo.
Mulo.
Manusia pertama. Tadi juga sudah sedikit disampaikan di biografi. Kalau background saya bukan mengenai gender ini, bukan dari background akademisi, tapi lebih ke saya mengalaminya secara langsung, dan emang punya ketertarikan yang sangat kuat untuk melakukan eksperimen-eksperimen mengenai gender dan seksualitas. Dan di usia 15 tahun saya sudah menjadi pekerja seks di Jakarta, waktu itu sekitar usia SMP. Jadi bolak balik Jakarta kasih. Terus SMA mulai seneng-seneng dada ngikutin kakak kelas yang cewek-cewek, karena gaulnya lebih banyak yang cewek.
Pelan-pelan ya, soalnya dia sambil nerjemahin.
Nah, karena hal itu kemudian saya berusaha tuangkan ke dalam karya foto. Sebenarnya karyanya juga ada karya performance, tapi dari semua yang akan saya sampaikan semuanya karya yang berbentuk foto. Ini karya tahun 2013 kalau nggak salah, kolaborasi sama Nicole Mendes. Dia fotografer dari Belgia. Ini lebih menunjukin ke performan gender saya di lingkungan masyarakat secara luas. Foto ini lebih mendeskripsikan bagaimana saya pulang ke kampung halaman, ke Tasik, yang harus menggunakan kopiah karena keluarga saya di keluarga muslim dan selama 17 tahun saya dikurung di pondok pesantren. Kenapa kemudian di belakangnya dikasih Garuda? Seperti kawan-kawan semua ketahui bahwa isu LGBT di Indonesia tiap tahun terus panas gitu kondisinya, terkait dengan kepentingan politik dan NGO juga. Jadi saya kasih Garuda sebagai pertanyaan sebenarnya, apakah Garuda melindungi kita atau malah membangsa kita sebagai protektor atau sebagai predator? Foto selanjutnya, ini kondisi di mana saya biasanya
kecepatan kata Agni.
Ini foto biasanya kondisi di mana saya bergaul dengan teman-teman yang sebagian sudah paham kondisi gender saya dan sebagian yang belum, jadi masih setengah-setengah gitu. Nah, ternyata kondisi seperti ini juga dianggap mengganggu di komunitas wanita. Jadi sekitar tahun 2008 saya sampai di Jogja untuk pertama kalinya, mendapatkan banyak label juga dari teman-teman komunitas LGBT. Saya dibilang homo dandan, saya dibilang waria bongkar pasang karena makeupnya nggak 24 jam. Terus saya dibilang laki-laki malas kerja karena profesi saya mengamen. Begitu. Dan kemudian foto selanjutnya adalah foto di mana saya merasa puas mengekspresikan diri saya apa adanya, tapi kemudian hal itu hanya bisa saya lakukan di lingkungan-lingkungan tertentu. Misalnya di lingkungan teman-teman yang benar-benar sudah memahami saya, sudah bisa menerima saya tanpa ada perdebatan dan buang-buang waktu.
Mungkin aku summary sedikit ya. I think it's easier if you go back to the first, balik lagi. So there are, this is the the photography project when he performed the different characteristic of the gendered body. So this is like when he come back to his hometown and he has to act as a Muslim, as she mentioned. And then the second one, she use like half-half identity. Like sometimes she become a man, sometimes she become a woman. But with this strategy, she often got insulted from the transgender community because they felt like she's kind of like half-half in between situation, not really came out with her true sexual identity. And then the ini yang terakhir ya. And then this is the photograph when she really feels comfortable with identity to show her body as a woman within like social circle. Ini yang ini di antara teman-temannya kan. So she can be freely express her choice of sexual identity.
Nah, setelah hari ini dipamerkan, kemudian saya mulai memikirkan ulang hal yang tersebut gitu. Ternyata sisi feminin sama sisi maskulin di dalam tubuh saya itu bisa dimain perankan dengan sangat fleksibel. Tapi kemudian ada pertanyaan lain, siap atau tidak saya menceritakan pengalaman batin yang saya alami terhadap orang tua. Nah pas sekalinya punya keberanian, saya memutuskan untuk membicarakan itu semua ke orang tua. Ayah saya menerima, tapi kemudian dia berpikir karena gak nyangka, karena punya wadang terus sampai masuk rumah sakit dan meninggal. Tapi kemudian ibu bisa total menerima. Jadi saya sudah gak peduli lagi gitu, mau pakai apapun, mau berekspresi apapun gitu. Karena support sistem yang paling kuat itu buat saya pribadi adalah dari keluarga sendiri gitu. Kalau yang lainnya udah beramal yang peduli. Nah tapi kemudian selama saya berproses atau melakukan aktivisme LGBT di teman-teman komunitas warga, saya juga kemudian menanyakan tentang ketubuhan. Kenapa kemudian banyak sekali teman-teman warga yang melakukan operasi kelamin, operasi payudara, atau melakukan suntik silikon tanpa edukasi yang cukup. Mereka mengalami di bagian dagu, bagian pipi, dan itu mereka memimpin sendiri. Ini dokumentasi saat saya mendampingi salah satu teman waria untuk operasi kelamin dan operasi payudara di Bangkok sekitar tahun 2014. Nah, saya kira adanya ketidakpahaman mengenai si sisi maskulin dan feminin itu bisa dimain perankan dengan sangat gampang dan penerimaan terhadap tubuhnya dia sendiri, yang kemudian mendorong si teman-teman waria untuk melakukan tindakan operasi gitu. Dan itu sebenarnya sangat beresiko sekali. Tapi kemudian ini menjadi perdebatan yang sangat panjang juga sama teman-teman waria, karena itu hak mereka juga gitu, dan gak bisa dilarang. Tapi setidaknya mereka melakukan pilihan tersebut atas dasar kesadaran penuh. Jadi ya saya biarkan aja. Nah kaitannya tadi dengan aktivisme saya malah lebih ke melakukan pendekatan atau mengindahkan wilayah mereka yang biasanya di jalan atau di dunia malam, itu pun juga sebenarnya jadi masalah itu pilihan mereka. Tapi yang jadi pertanyaannya kemudian sadar atau tidak salah menggunakan kesadaran teman-teman sebenarnya. Nah saya memindahkan teman-teman pengamen untuk melakukan pertunjukan di via-via dan di beberapa kafe gitu. Terus kemudian lebih mengajak mereka untuk terlibat dalam aktivitas sosial seperti salah satunya ini. Kami mengajar edutainment sama memberikan pendidikan seks yang sehat. Waktu itu lokasinya di Lapas Cebongan sebelum penembakan terjadi tahun 2015 kalau misalnya penembakan itu. Nah setelah itu semua kemudian saya juga mempertanyakan ulang kondisi tubuh saya gitu. Kalau saya sudah sefluid itu sebenarnya, punya pemikiran sefluid itu, secair itu gitu, bagaimana saya memposisikan tubuh nih sebagai relasi sosial dengan sesama, dengan perempuan ataupun dengan laki-laki gitu. Berikut dengan konflik-konflik yang terjadi di sosial juga. Ini karya saya masih sama Mikor Nebus juga tahun 2016, sempat dipamerkan di Via-Via dan di suruh diturunkan, terus sempat diteror sama polisi, ada 8 polisi yang datang dan pamerannya hampir gak jadi. Tapi kami kemudian menyiasatinya untuk menurunkan karya-karya yang dianggap sebagai pornografi. Ini relasi saya dengan laki-laki sebenarnya. Dan akhirnya setelah paham itu semua, jadinya tuh kayak problem-problem yang dialami oleh waria itu gak ada bedanya dengan problem-problem yang dialami oleh perempuan ataupun dengan laki-laki gitu. Kalau ngomongin equality ya, cuman kan kemudian kembali ke kesadaran, kamu mau memposisikan dirimu di mana dan mengambil posisi apa?
I think it will be quite long. So after that first photo project and she came out to the family about the sexual orientation and preference. At the same time, she comes to the understanding that the femininity and masculinity can be fluidly exchanged. So it doesn't matter you have a male body or female body unless you have the awareness of who you are. So she works also with other transgender community and trying to share her experience of like forming this awareness. So this photography actually came from her experience of accompany some of her friends who did some surgery in Bangkok. So she started to question why you should change your body if actually the feminine and the masculine can be exchanged. So she started a project, or also not really project, but her activism, where she gathered or she collected her friends, also the transgender community who usually play music, play singing on the streets and get money. Ngamen tuh apa?
Basker,
ya. Yeah. And then working with Via Via, one of quite famous restaurant in Jogja. I think you've quite familiar with Via Via, and to give them the stage to perform in this restaurant instead of only doing that on the street. So for her, it's quite important to for like to share this awareness with her friends. And she did also some projects in apa sih?
Prisons.
And after that, she started another photography project, still with me. Cornadeus. With me, when she tried to portray the form of relationship that she had as either as a male or female, and how she relates with other women or other men. And it's very interesting that she points out that for her, the problem of being transgender actually is not distinguished, or is not different from the problem that belongs to women's body or men's body. For her, it doesn't matter. So she doesn't feel like she needs to make the positions become special just because you're transgender, right? Okay.
Tadi sampai mana? Oh, udah yang fotografi.
Yang fotografi. So this is all the projects when she tries to portray the differences of relationships.
Lalu
kemudian pada karena sebelumnya sejak tahun 2008 sampai sekitar tahun 2012 saya berada di aktivisme LGBT, dan kemudian saya merasa dibolehkan dan selalu diposisikan bahwa saya selalu diposisikan untuk menuntut ke negara, untuk menuntut ke lingkungan, memaksa lingkungan untuk mengakui saya, memaksa lingkungan untuk mengakui keberadaan saya. Dan setelah saya melakukan ini semua, kemudian jadi berpikir ini yang salah tuh kita atau masyarakat. Pada kenyataannya ternyata ada politik NGO juga gitu, dan politik pemerintah gitu. Dan itu yang saya sedang pelajari juga gitu, bukan hanya wariannya sekarang, bukan cuma komunitas LGBT-nya gitu, tapi NGO-nya juga gitu, bukan yang mencerdaskan si teman-teman LGBT, tapi malah jadinya membolehkan dengan program-program yang menurut saya nggak masuk akal, gitu. Hanya lulus soal HIV/AIDS, hanya lulus soal kesehatan seksual, gitu. Seolah-olah kita jadi epidemi HIV, gitu. Itu kan gila. Gitu. Nah, kemudian yang saya lakukan adalah di bidang human dengan mendekati tiap individu, gitu. Memberikan alternatif pekerjaan lain seperti misalnya di Jogja, seperti Afika yang sempat 2 tahun kerja di Jogja jadi server, dan itu berhasil gitu, meskipun dia waria dan gak ada yang mempermasalahkan itu. Terus yang terbaru adalah saya membentuk sebuah grup vokal, fotonya kurang jelas, ini grup vokalnya namanya Mubah. Dan ini seneng banget karena berhasil membawa 3 waria yang ngamen di jalan, terus disupport sama teman-teman seniman juga gitu, ada yang jadi vokal coach, ada yang jadi musik engineering, ada yang jadi director gitu buat project band ini. Dan kami akan launching mini album ini di tanggal 28 September, tapi sebelumnya kami sudah perform kemarin di DBY pas opening Nandos Rabu, dan pas lihat kami perform ternyata antusias orang tuh yang gila banget gitu, kok bisa mulai jadi elegan kayak gitu dengan voice vokal bukan lip sync. Dan ya dipanggil banget gitu, terus akhirnya diundang lagi sama pihak TBI untuk acara pembukaan pameran. Dan seneng banget melihat itu semua. Sementara di aktivisme saya yang lain, saya sedang menjalankan proyek Response Pembeng Experience Transspecies Possibilities. Saya bekerja sama dengan scientist dari lucu ya. Saya bekerja sama dengan scientist dari Amerika sama dari Australia. Jadi karena bank sperma di Indonesia masih belum ada undang-undangnya, jadi saya pikir saya masih aman dengan mungkin atau polisi gitu, untuk melakukan proyek ini di sini. Nah, tawaran saya kemudian ke masyarakat Indonesia adalah memberikan tawaran kalau kamu sebagai orang tua generasi muda yang sudah menikah dan pengen punya anak, sekarang kamu udah punya pilihan loh, anakku mau wanita, mau gay, mau lesbi, bisa dengan mudah spermanya direkayasa, atau warna kulitnya mau warna putih, warna kuning, warna hijau kayak gold gitu. Warna-warna, whatever itu mungkin sekali gitu, selama bentuknya masih sperma. Selain itu, kenapa di water performance ini saya pilih global? Akhirnya kemudian saya menyimpulkan bahwa kondisi LGBT di Indonesia ini sebenarnya sama kayak pedagang kaki lima di Indonesia atau di kota-kota besar seperti Jakarta. Mereka ilegal, tapi mereka tetap melakukan dan juga tetap dibutuhkan oleh warga sekitar. Tetap aja ada orang yang beli. Jelas-jelas trotoar itu buat orang jalan, tapi dipakai buat jualan, itu ilegal dan gak punya izin. Tapi tetap aja jualan, dan tetap aja ada yang beli. Nah begitu pun waria, tapi kemudian gak bisa dianalogikan sesimpel itu sih sebenarnya. Tapi ya ini sindiran yang lebih mudah diterima oleh masyarakat umum. Nah selain itu, ya saya masih melanjutkan riset saya mengenai waria Nusantara. Itu saja mungkin. Oh sama ini harus ada satu dokumentasi video sebenarnya. Jadi sekitar tahun 2006, isu LGBT di Indonesia meledak dan taruh-taruhan. Dan kalau teman-teman yang tinggal di Jogja, itu biasanya di perempatan-perempatan liar banner yang tolak LGBT. Nah, saya itu mendokumentasikannya dengan ambil videonya sendiri dan biasanya keluar jam 3 pagi. Terus saya locokin si spanduknya, nunggu sepi gitu, karena takut juga. Salah satunya seperti ini.
So this is documentary from her previous project where she in 2016 there was lots of protests or protests from the society to against the LGBT community. So they put lots of banners in the public areas on the street.
Udah selesai.
On the street, and Tamara perform is like respond to these banners, and every night, like almost 3 or 4 a.m. in the morning, she went out and she unfold those banners from the street, and then those are the documentations. How many banners that you
managed?
Only 5.
That's enough for make a dress.
Did you make the dress?
Yes.
Okay, thank you, Tamara.
Terima kasih.
Ini tadi dengar nggak sih? Nggak ada mati. Nggak. So the last presenter for this section. How to pronounce your name?
G.
So the last presenter of this session is G. Iman Semalar. G. Iman Semalar is a trans activist, writer, theater artist, and filmmaker. He completed his postgraduate studies in arts and aesthetic from the Jawaharlal Nehru University, New Delhi. He co-founded Panmai Theatre Group along with Living Smile Vidya and Angel Plady in 2014. He's interested in using theater of the oppressed to bring social change around various issues. The debut production of Panmai Theatre is Color of Trans 2.0, which was devised by the founders based on their own lives of trans people, was toured in Philadelphia, New York, Boston, Chennai, Bangalore, Kerala, and Karnataka in 2015. G directed
G directed one of the first films on Transmed in South India titled Kalvedugal or Sculpture in 2012. He has also recently co-directed and acted in a stop-motion animation film When the Real Transformers Please Stand Up. He continues to do performative intervention in social movements and public spaces and believes in the power of art as a political tool. Please.
Mm-hmm. I'd like to thank Adrian for inviting me here, and I think you spoke it justice that the most heterosexual of the panelists is speaking at the back end of the panel. So I was asked whether I had any slides, and my response to that was that everyone sitting in the room is my slide. Because I would like to shift the burden of gender from the panelists who are sitting here to everyone who is placed in this room. So I would say that you are my text, whether you think of yourself as passive objects or active subjects. I would like you to interrogate and examine the ways in which gender is embodied and expressed by you. Because I find that it's quite commonplace to put LGBTI people on a panel and we speak about gender, but if gender is dramaturgy, then everyday life is also dramaturgy. And I would like you to think of all of yourselves as dramaturgs in this process. So I think there are two ways of looking at gender. One is of course something that my co-panelists spoke about, which is your relationship to yourself and your body. And the second, I would say, is your relationship to society. Of course, your relationship to yourself is also mediated by social and cultural values, right? So the gap between the two is not so distinct. But one of the primary questions that I try to question in my art is how to visualize our identities, since we are historically invisibilized. But at the same time, how do we not other ourselves, or how do we not show ourselves as different, right? So I would like to briefly touch upon gender and unpack gender for you, because the whole of the morning we have been unpacking dramaturgy, what it means, what it doesn't mean, and all of that. So let me just briefly touch upon gender. So a lot of you might already know this, you know that gender does not exist in vacuum. It is socially and culturally mediated and produced through discursive systems. So all of you might also be aware of Judith Butler, who is one of the foundation scholars in gender studies, who says that gender identity becomes intelligible only through socially recognized norms. And how you do this is through repetition. So every day you repeat certain gestures and then you create the single category of gender. So this is different from saying that you are performing gender, because then it means that you are taking a role that already exists and you are performing that. So performativity of gender is different because it means that there is nothing inherent about ways of being men or women, that all of this is socially constructed through repetitive actions in everyday life. So if you were to look at gender as performative, then all of life is a performance and all of life is dramaturgically produced. So if we look at this as a social phenomenon that is being produced and reproduced all the time, we act, walk, sit in particular ways that stabilize this category. So even if you look at the legality of gender identity or sexuality, all of you might be aware that yesterday the Supreme Court of India has decriminalized homosexuality in Section 377. And if you were to look at the archival records of the first time this case was used, one of the first times was in 1884. And it was used against a person who was gender deviant, who was dancing in feminine clothes on the streets of Allahabad. So this of course ensued in a legal case where the medical evidence was difficult to ascertain because they did an examination of this person's body, and though this person's body was analyzed and dissected to show that this person was habitually accustomed to anal sex. There was no real evidence that it could be pinned down on this person. So that person is recorded in history as Kairathi. Of course, this is not that person's name, but it's a fictional name that is given to the character. So if the binary is part of all performances, then is there such a thing called gender dramaturgy that's separate from all the dramaturgy that you see around you? Isn't all the dramaturgy always already gender? So the communication of a gender or gender identity involves not just a performance but also a reception. And this is also something that we've been talking about the whole day. And if you look at cinema studies, Laura Mulvey's idea of the male gaze, and Barbara Friedman's idea of the disruptive gaze. This is particularly important because if we were to construct a gender dramaturgy that if, sorry, I know that Indians and Sri Lankans are the most colonial in our English and I need to slow down, so I can slow down. So how do we create a performance that deconstructs the sexual difference, right? And how do we do gender, or how do we undo gender? These are the primary questions that I have been trying to grapple with. And it really matters to us to look at whether a queer dramaturg or a queer performer on stage necessarily makes a performance queer in content. So if you look at the process of production and the relation of that production with the audience, I think a lot of the answers would lie there in the unpacking of those relations. So if we look at the strategies that have been used historically and currently in queer performances, you would see that there is a shift away from realism because realism is often seen to create this kind of seamless narrative where reality and what is represented gets blurred, right? And so it stabilizes whatever you're trying to show there rather than show gender as constructed. And I think this is one of the reasons why a lot of queer performances move away from realist ways of showing or performing to anti-realist ways. So even if you look at the word queer, much like dramaturgy, it is not something that is translatable in the political sense to most of our local languages, right? And epistemologically as well, queer is something that cannot be contained. It is something that is always in excess. And this is something that you see even in the performance of queer. It is always something that spills over. It's always something that is in excess. So incidentally, when I saw Tamara, I went up to her and I said, you know, you must be Tamara. And later on I said, the way I recognized you is because the most gorgeous woman who wears the highest heels in the room has to always be a trans woman. So the ways in which this excess, you know, whether it's on stage or in everyday life, we embody that excess. We cannot be contained by legalities, illegalities, we cannot be contained by norms, and I think that is where a lot of radical potential comes from. Now, I would like to just briefly look at queer gender dramaturgy and the strategies that it uses. A lot of the things have already been covered in the presentations that came before me, and you would see that camp is one such performance technique that is used. Drag is another. And if you look historically at drag, it was an underground movement when it was criminalized to wear clothes of the opposite gender. That drag went underground and it became an expression of a subversive resistance. But of course now it is commercialized in a lot of contexts. Pop culture is accepting of drag. Multiculturalism wants to show that everyone is equal and acceptable. So you see that from RuPaul to your local drag performances, you would see that there are critiques of drag performances as parodies or imitations of hyper-femininity. So if we are trying to look at queer dramaturgy through drag performances, the question really is, does drag destabilize the category of gender, or does it reinforce those gender categories? So you would see that there are gender neutral mimes, absurd is an element that is used often, clown, the use of expletives or improper behavior, self-deprecating humor. Of course, a lot of you would have seen Hannah Gadsby's stand-up comedy. So what are these techniques of portraying gender stereotypes? And when do they fall into the trap of fetishism? Right? Because this is what the audience wants to see. And so how do we market ourselves, how do we commodify ourselves into exactly the kind of package that the audience wants? And how do we subvert those expectations? I think this is central to thinking about queer dramaturgy. So do the essentialist ways in which gender is understood get disrupted through these performances, or do they get stabilized further? So if you look at drag, especially if you look at voguing, which is a form that is used by the African-American gender non-conforming communities, a lot of you might have seen Paris's Burning. So the performance that you see in that is voguing. And of course, this has gone across borders, and there are voguing queens in Thailand that are going viral on social media and YouTube. So if you look at voguing, the issue of race and class and how these categories get transcended. Because in voguing, you would see that it comes from, of course, the fashion vogue and the fashionable strikes, the poses that the models strike for the cover of the Vogue magazine. And you would see that poor working class African American communities use voguing in a particular way that challenges this racial and class construct and, of course, gender. Right, so even if you look at drag performances, you would see that a lot of Asian queens, they might fetishize themselves or commodify themselves in the typical oriental mode. And there are others who, through the use of just organic material, like they make shoes themselves and they're strutting along in the paddy fields. And you see that kind of subversion also happens across race and class categories. So there is radical potential in all of that, but I think that we have to be extremely critical at every stage to really know what the purpose of queer dramaturgy is and whether we are using it to really subvert the identities that have oppressed us. So if we want to represent race or caste in the Indian context or gender, how would we bring these signifiers into the queerness of performance? That is, I think, important, because we are not just our gender, right? We are also the locations of multiple other identities. So how do we represent the local in the global economy of performance without really becoming commodities? And I think this is central to understanding queer dramaturgy. So if you look at the quest for authenticity, I think O'Neill has also touched upon this kind of gender role reversal in traditional performance pieces. And if you look at the history of a lot of performances, and including Indian theatre, you would see that historically men used to play the roles of women. And of course, this was linked to ideas of publicness, it was linked to ideas of immorality. From Shakespeare in drama, like you want to take the canon, like within the canon, men were playing women, right? And a lot of Asian performances do subscribe to this model of gender role reversal. So if we were to look at those kind of historical ways in which gender role reversal happened, you would see that it was to, in fact, relegate the women to the domestic and to not allow that public space to be inhabited by them in the very public way that performances are done. If you look at the history of blackface in minstrel shows, you would see that a lot of white people used to cover their faces with black and do racist parodies of narratives. If you look at Malayalam cinema, for example, P.K. Rosi, one of the first Malayalam actresses in 1928, who worked in the first film that emerged from Kerala called Vidathukumaran, she was an ex-untouchable woman, a Dalit woman, who played the role of a prominent caste woman. And the theatre was attacked, the film was stopped, she had to flee from her village, and there's nothing really known about her. Some histories say that she committed suicide, some histories say that she migrated to the neighbouring state of Tamil Nadu. So if we look at representation, who represents who, in what ways and why? I think these are central, because I think that it's important to realize that always the people with privilege have the artistic freedom to represent anyone across gender, across race, across caste. But then the subaltern identities or the subaltern performers are always stuck in this kind of prison where we have to always embody our lived experiences. And I think this is something that I'm growing tired of, this is something that I want to move away from. And if we look at the masculinist strategies of legitimation in theatre, like what is appropriate or what is mainstream theatre and what is inappropriate or alternative or subaltern theatre, you would see that a lot of these power relations are still very stable, in the sense that the more commercially successful, the more mainstream theatre is always theatre that does not mark itself in terms of identity. It just tells stories, and it's free enough to just tell stories. But our theatre is always something that is rooted in oppression. We have to bear our pain, you know, we have to become, our pain has to become consumable in certain ways to the audience. And this is something that we need to be very wary of. And at the same time, I would also like to pose the question of whether the alternative is oppositional, because often the alternative can complement the mainstream in various ways that I mentioned about that. So is it possible to conclude, to transcend the fixed and often sterile categories of gender that is imposed on us, even as we act in defensiveness, or even if we act in assertion? You know, there are two different phases that you can use. It's from communication theory, which is the negative phase and the positive phase, all right? And the positive phase is something that you want to show to seek acceptance. And the negative phase is something that you want to show because you don't want to be impeded by the categories that are given to you. And I think trans or queer performances are in some kind of liminal space between these two. And there's a constant tension between that. So how do we really come out of this kind of psychic imprisonment that we as queer people in performance are constantly trapped by? And this reminds me of the idea of the mestiza consciousness, which Chitana feminist called Gloria and Zantua talks about. And she talks about how our consciousness is always in some kind of liminal space where it defies the borders that have been set for us. So how do we kind of think about our identities through this consciousness rather than through biologically determined categories? And James Baldwin, in his essay Nobody Knows My Name, he talks about how he wants to prevent himself from becoming merely a Negro. And I quote, that's what he's written in his own words, "The world tends to trap and immobilize you in the role that you play." And I would like to think collectively with all of you to kind of create some kind of heteroglossia of genders in our quest for performative freedoms. And I hope that you will walk with me in this journey. Thank you.
Sorry that in the middle of the conversation that we are kind of lost in translation. So I offer actually, because the presentation is very interesting and important to be translated. So is it possible that your notes,
yeah,
and
I can share.
You can share to the committee, and then they will translate like over the night and give them in printed materials in order. Thank you.
Sorry, I don't have a
story. It's already sorry for you. Okay, it's quite different from the previous panelists, from previous panels. Today, for this session, we have two respondents that will give their comments and response to the presentation. So we have here Brigitta Isabella and Naomi Srikandi. So Brigitta is a researcher and writer. She works for Cultural Studies Center. Her background actually studies philosophy. So please,
thank you. You made my position as a critical respondent this year, perhaps after, because you already posed a lot of interesting and important questions in relation to performativity and gender. Because I was planning also to talk about taking into account the lens of performativity, think about gender, which I'm sure everyone here of course familiar with the Butler and how her idea of Bunny as a site for constructing identity is already as you mentioned, used to think about the productivity and gender. But at the same time, I think you also, on the last part, you mentioned about Kikana feminist thinkers who actually push the idea of performativity to also think about positionality. And there are also like different embodied experience and cannot be universalized to be just performativity as if it's universal and for everyone, because obviously there's also privilege in doing performativity. So I think your point about positionality is something that I want to also think through when we talk about what O'Neill and Tamara discussed about their performance, but also their embodied experience. With O'Neill, what I think is important when he talked about the Langer and Nyawiji is related with how local vocabularies can be a resource for I don't know whether alternative is the right term, but another narrative for the universalizing LGBT movement. Because perhaps one of the most perhaps famous case just happened in 2017 in East London, when perhaps some of you are familiar with this case, where white LGBT activists came to East London and they do their pride parade. But then claiming a lot of Islamophobic narratives without any how queer Muslim also negotiate between their queerness and their Muslim identity. So I found that local vocabularies which O'Neill tried to perform in Nyawiji, in conceptualizing and performing the Nyawiji bodies and also through Langer performance is important resource to negotiating LGBT movement in Indonesia, in Indonesian context. Because what happened in 2016, as you see in what Tamara showed of the banners, it's all anti-LGBT. But we actually have the term wanita, which means wanita pria or female male.
Female.
And wanita is already used since 70s. Actually, it's a derivative term by the New Order regime. But at the same time, the wanita activists also use it productively to have a safe space in the society. But then when the term LGBT movement came with the pride parade and all the rainbow thing, some of the warrior people in maybe Tamara can also correct me if I'm wrong, but as far as I know, some of the warrior, they don't want to be included in the LGBT because it's not safe for them. Because here, LGBT considered to be an important ideology from the West, say with feminism. When you claim yourself as feminist here, perhaps it happened everywhere, people will thought you just a Western educated, liberated woman. But therefore I have Langer, Nyawiji, and Tamara, I think, is also now doing her research on Nusantara?
Transgender Archipelago,
which also
in Sulawesi, with the Yesus community.
I believe you can also share with us that very important and interesting resources to create another narratives. To, I don't know, compliment, as you said, about the drag and the mainstream idea of LGBT. Because LGBT is also, I believe, or queer community is also not an absolute or single subjectivities. As we see in the case of white LGBT movement in London, there are also fascism inside the queer community. So therefore, I believe local resources and also looking at the positionality of the queer community inside and the conflict of friendship of ideology inside the community is also very important really push forward the idea about push the idea of performativity to positionality. Therefore, I found Tamara positionality is really interesting, not only because she really embodied the experience of being discriminated not only through her besides her sexual preference, but also she experienced economic discrimination and her art and activism. I think create a place of enunciation not only in the bodies but also in collective bodies, particularly in particular class. So therefore it's also my question to every one of you, because Gee, I think you mentioned a little bit that haven't really expand the idea of case, which is, I think, quite particular in Indian experience, but perhaps can be interesting to compare with the class struggle in the queer community. Do I still have time?
1 minute?
1 minute. What else? Perhaps I will also ask to Othniel about, on the one hand, of course, it's related with when we use local as our narrative resources, it's also a currency, particularly when you're an artist and you become part of the global contemporary art. It's a question related to what happens when bodies travel from the local to the cosmopolitan space. What negotiation do you consider important, or is there any kind of oppression where your body again be discriminated perhaps by the cosmopolitan space, or you find liberation instead in that space? So yeah, I think that's all my comment. And you can expand it now.
No, nanti dimainin yang bisa
dilakukan. Aduh, udah lupa.
Oke, aku.
Ya. So the second respondent will be Naomi Srikani. Naomi is a writer and also a theater director. She's based in Yogyakarta.
Earlier I had a talk with Brigitta. She begged me to give her the first opportunity to speak because she was afraid that she will, you know, run out of question if I was to speak first. But now I'm in that position. She already told me that we have discussed a bit because we were sent their resumes and their work samples. So before this panel, we already like see some of even if Gee, he doesn't really show the slides, but we kind of know a bit what you did. Yeah, it was like for O'Neill, first, I think my question is already like asked by Gita. It's regarding his discipline in the performing art tradition, that very strong discipline. And to be honest, when I saw O'Neill's video, it was in Jogja or in the one that very simple, you were like, it was more like traditional, but it's already, of course, you saw it in through contemporary lens. But that was simple and I was thrilled. And after seeing that video, I saw the other one that was the latest one in Eurovalia, and that looked more cosmopolite in a way, you know. And so it's have that kind of curiosity. how O'Neill has been doing from one point to another point, knowing that O'Neill has a very strong tradition in this language. And it was now you're still playing in my mind the way he dance. It's very beautifully done and powerful. And unfortunately, when I saw the other video that was a performance in the Eurovalia, it was not really clear for me to see the whole thing. But the pictures you just show us was helpful for me. I can see the strength of your craftsmanship, but at the same time, I can also see your body as an agent there. That's about O'Neill. To add to what Brigitta already mentioned about Nyawiji, about this vocabulary, our own, our local vocabulary regarding gender performativity. I second that yeah, I think we it's a good strategy to reclaim all these old local words. Even though I believe if I think some of you who are involved in the LGBT movements already also, you know, we are aware of what how the Indonesian LGBT movement actually did try to reclaim these words like waria and everything. Even like we have bisu in Bugis culture, you know, that we are not like traditionally our culture are not constructed like as, you know, men and women, you know, this in this binary position, not like that. We were putting some of our locals, it was already acknowledged that we have many more than two genders. There's also maybe my position here is like I'm trying to balance Gita's position. Because I am part of the LGBT movement, and maybe the question to follow to what Gita already emphasized is that now we know that through this artist research and practices, gender is not this or that clear. It is liquid. Like in O'Neill say that this Nyawiji is a fusion of femininity and masculinity, and within that strategy, it can be,
you know, I finish.
Oh, sorry. Now I have to finish now.
Yeah, like one more minute. Yeah.
Is that his performance cannot be done here? We have in Indonesia, we have this kind of anti-LGBT movement. But then when he traveled to Belgium and he performed this piece that show the first discussion of femininity and masculinity, this liquidity of gender, it suddenly people can talk about it. Or I don't know if it's also, the question is, did that discourse were brought back here in Indonesia? This kind of artistic approach, how much it can be used to actually not to, you know, to push away LGBT movement strategy or the way people think about LGBT, but to play as maybe not alternative, but this is like a definitely a way to rethink about how this advocacy should be done or can be done to be more. Can be probably. And also really, because this is also, I just want to say a bit about what Tamara said. After she fell through this research and artistic experimentations, she felt more equipped. But then she also had this question, what is my body then? So this leads her to her several other experimentations and artworks. But again, I'm asking the three of you now, does it matter for you to actually compete to the movements of non-artistic movements to say what's truly there in our achieved lives? Or is it, or do you think it would be too much for me to dare you to just keep on breaking these walls and negotiate? Thank you.
Yeah, thank you.
I have one more 2 minutes.
No more, yeah?
No.
Yeah, we cannot, yeah. Sorry, because 2 minutes can be fine. So, I'll be very strict about this, yeah. Mungkin saya sedikit memberi pengantar untuk teman-teman menjawab gitu ya. Mungkin Oatmeal bisa cerita sedikit bagaimana sih sebenarnya proses penciptaan ketika tertarik pada lendir, apakah juga punya entah motivasi atau gagasan atau titik berangkat yang juga melihat posisi LGBT dalam kehidupan sosial, atau sebenarnya itu benar-benar eksplorasi tubuh dalam rangka mencari gagasan-gagasan artistik atau estetik. Itu untuk menjawab dua. Sebenarnya pertanyaannya lebih kompleks daripada itu, tapi mungkin kamu mencatatkan tadi.
Terima kasih, saya itu juga jawabnya dari berdasarkan pengalaman yang saya dapatkan ketika saya melakukan riset dan engagement, bahwa saya mencoba untuk mengungkapkan kenyataan yang ada di sekeliling saya yang ada di Banyumas, dan mencoba untuk mengungkapkan hal yang disembunyikan gitu. Jadi pendekatan saya terhadap kehidupan religian yang ada di Banyumas, lalu saya mencoba untuk memahami dan akhirnya memunculkan sebuah nilai-nilai yang saya dapatkan kepada kehidupan religian, dan akhirnya saya aplikasikan dan saya relasikan terhadap pendekatan-pendekatan terhadap situasi yang ada pada saat ini gitu. Terus di sini saya juga tidak mau kampanye tentang LGBT sebenarnya. Jadi saya justru malah memberikan wawasan baru tentang pemahaman tentang lengger itu sendiri, bagaimana bisa menjadi akar dari pergerakan gender yang pergerakan dari performa gender yang sangat sulit di tradisi dan tradisi kita. Jadi kalau misalnya saya tentang gender di barat itu sangat kaku ya, laki-laki harus bergerak di wilayah publik, yang perempuan harus bergerak di wilayah domestik. Dan kalau di Banyumas sendiri, lengger bisa berperan walaupun dia berperan perempuan, tapi ketika dia menari dia juga bisa melakukan hal seperti ya mengacul, dan juga dia bisa masak, dan dia juga bisa memotong rambut dan sebagainya gitu. Jadi hal yang dilakukan oleh lengger itu juga bisa semuanya bisa dilakukan oleh satu orang gitu. Terus uh, Terus untuk pendekatan artistik yang saya lakukan itu sebenarnya peranan dramaturgi. Jadi ketika mungkin perkembangan dari bentuk visual yang ada pada Dino Signore dan juga perbedaannya di negara itu sangat jauh sekali karena karena perkembangan saya mengetahui tentang hal gender gitu. Tapi saya tetap tidak meninggalkan dari apa yang saya dapati dan saya pahami tentang nilai-nilai yang ada di lainnya.
Kalau pertanyaan tadi dua-duanya ya, dari Gita dan Naomi, ada soal tubuh yang berpetualang, pergi, kan? Apa beda nggak sih menampilkan itu di sini dalam konteks Indonesia, tubuhmu itu, dan menampilkannya dalam konteks yang lebih kosmopolit gitu, di Eropa? Apakah ada pergeseran juga soal menampilkan identitas gendernya?
Kalau saya sendiri dari pergeseran ya mungkin apa namanya lebih kepada merayakan tubuh sendiri gitu. Jadi pada dasarnya kita merayakan tubuh negara itu sendiri gitu. Tidak ada batasannya gitu. Saya dari sini dimanapun dia berada gitu mengikuti arus dan juga tapi karena dia mengulang terus dan konsisten lama-lama menjadi kuat tubuhnya gitu.
Kamu mau kamu pertanyaannya?
Aku juga rada.
Apa beri kita pertanyaannya?
Yang saya tak marah tadi apa ya?
Enggak
sih, tahu.
Kalau aku tadi pertanyaannya lebih sebenarnya soal.
Oh ya, proyek barumu ya, Arkipelago.
Local resource dari sejarah tubuh-tubuh yang punya di pemerintahan. Sama itu soal apakah kamu sendiri melihat, bagaimana kamu sendiri melihat gagasan LGBT yang kadang-kadang berhubungan seringkali dilihat ke masyarakat sebagai import dari barat, misalkan moral versus bahasa-bahasa yang tentunya kayak wanita yang lebih aman digunakan untuk bahkan berkampanye, bagaimana kamu menggunakan itu misalnya dalam nanti kamu mau apa launching baru apa yang
Oke.
Setelah saya kuliah di sana Tari Dharma dan ngambil sejarah, ini baru kelas ke minggu ketiga ya. Alhamdulillah otak saya mikirnya lebih tersistem. Jadi di persoalan dramaturgi performance ini ada tiga yang saya lihat sebagai persoalan. Yang pertama, persoalan NGO, persoalan NGO yang concern terhadap LGBT. Yang kedua, konteks waria sekarang setelah dilabelin LGBT. Yang ketiga, konteks waria sebelum mereka dapat label LGBT. Dan yang keempat, dan yang terakhir adalah saya nggak bisa menyebutkan bahwa mereka waria, tapi orang-orang yang melakukan praktik homoseksual sebagai ritual seperti bisu di Sulawesi, mereka kamu dijadikan sebagai bagian LGBT atau mereka kamu disebut sebagai waria atau bahkan mereka kamu disebut sebagai calabar, mereka menjadi sendiri sebagai seorang bisu, sebagai seorang sama. Nah, empat aspek ini memiliki persoalan masing-masing. Satu, si bisu dengan eksotismenya, mereka terus-terusan dieksploitasi tidak hanya oleh researcher, tetapi juga oleh seniman. Sebut saja misalnya yang terakhir saya dapati fakta si Robert Wilson yang melakukan teater ilegal itu dan kemudian juga melibatkan si bisu. Itu kan terjadi konflik internal di kabinet bisu karena yang selalu dibawa oleh Robert Wilson atau mungkin oleh direktur pertunjukan yang lain yang selalu si Kuang Matoa, si pimpinan bisunya ini dulu kebetulan dulu Kuang Matoanya adalah Saidi. Nah, bodohnya si Robert Wilson atau mungkin teman-teman senias yang lain tidak melakukan pendekatan secara antropologi. Mereka tidak tahu bahwa kemudian si para bisu ini tidak memiliki pendidikan seks yang cukup, pendidikan seks yang sehat yang cukup. Nah, si saya ini di Borso, termuter dunia atau termuter Indonesia, pulang-pulang dengan HIV. HIV juga merupakan hal baru di Sulawesi. Si komunitas ini mereka tidak ngerti HIV itu apa, kondom itu apa, mereka tidak ngerti. Yang mereka ngerti, oh saya ini kena santet dari yang lain karena cemburu. Saya ini tenar, saya ini punya banyak dolar. Dan keluarga saya ini kemudian menuntut bisu-bisu lain karena dianggap saya ini dibunuh, disantet. padahal saya ini nanti kena HIV. Ini out of record sebenarnya, dan tolong ke Maridia, ini nggak boleh dipublikasikan karena ngomongin tentang HIV itu ada undang-undangnya juga. Tapi ini fakta, fakta yang luar biasa gila gitu. Kalau kemudian segampang itu seniman mengeksploitasi eksotisme kebudayaan kita, gitu. Bahkan itu dalam orang luar, kita kecolongan, kecolongan. Terus setelah saya melakukan riset pertama ke sana sekitar tahun 2015, bisu ternyata faktanya sudah tidak ada. Di ilegal itu ter disebutkan bahwa bisu itu berasal dari kata mabesi, orang suci. Suci, suci tidak hanya secara rohani, tapi secara badani juga. Mereka selibat, mereka memilih untuk tidak melakukan hubungan seksual. Tapi pada kenyataannya setelah saya ke sana, menginterview beberapa bisu, bahkan yang di pelosok sekalipun, mereka punya pasangan. Dan itu fakta baru buat saya secara pribadi. Tapi kenapa kemudian masih banyak seniman yang menjual eksotisme palsu kemudian buat saya, yang mempertahankan mitos yang jelas-jelas nggak ada, gitu. Bahkan naskah ilegaligonya ada lagi yang punya, dan sekarang lagi diterjemahin dan dibentuk PDF penerjemahnya Profesor Lita Latif sama siapa satu lagi gitu, dan dibalikin ke Indonesia lagi mesti beli ya kalau terjemahannya benar. Kalau salah, kalau nggak ada selama ini ceritanya gitu. Karena kemudian sekarang bisu dilihat di konteks sekarang, mereka menjadikan naik haji sebagai status sosial gitu. Jadi semakin sering mereka naik haji, status sosialnya semakin tinggi. Nah, itu ada kaitannya dengan politik agama ya, kebetulan agama Islam. Mana tahu cerita ilegal itu dirubah, kemudian kayak Borobudur misalnya, kapal Sulaiman itu tuh kapal Sulaiman yang dari Borobudur. Nanti ilegal itu juga menjadi dirubah gitu, cerita-ceritanya. Nah, politik-politik yang nyebelin kayak gitu ya mesti diberesin gitu. Terus kalau melihat konteks warga zaman sekarang, ini seolah-olah kemudian diorganisir oleh NGO gitu, dibodohin oleh NGO, dibodohin oleh NGO. Pada kenyataannya kamu tuh bisa survive gitu. Dan paling benci banget dengan kata pemberdayaan. Lu pikir wadah itu berdaya. Terus ngomongin penolakan. Loh, kalau ditolak kenapa masih bisa tinggal di Jogja, masih bisa ngekos di Jogja? Yang menolak siapa? Kasus 2016 Pondok Pesantren Waria di bukan di Kusur ya, dilarang, didatengin, digerebek oleh FJI, Front Jihad Indonesia. Ya buat aku sebagai waria yang dianggap waria itu sendiri wajar gitu. Kamu ada di negara yang mayoritas Islam dan kalian semua Muslim, terus merumuskan fikih baru tentang waria, itu sama aja kayak kamu bikin agama di dalam agama, kamu bikin kompetisi dalam komunitas, bahkan gila juga. Oh, udah. satu lagi gitu. Ya tuntutan-tuntutannya kemudian jadi gak masuk akal gitu, karena itu tuntutan NGO, dan rata-rata orang yang bergerak ke NGO itu bukan orang-orang yang bagian dari teman-teman itu sendiri gitu, biasanya orang luar yang mengontrol mereka gitu. Mereka gak benar-benar paham kebutuhan mereka itu sebenarnya apa, keinginan mereka itu apa gitu. Dan kemudian ya yang saya bisa lakukan adalah mencari alternatif-alternatif lain gitu, dengan bukan menggiring ya, lebih ke inisiatif mereka aja, yang mereka senangi apa ya coba fasilitasi. Itu saja, terima kasih kalau sudah cukup.
I think I will open the floor and then for G, I will summarize like some of the questions that coming from the audience, and so you can respond directly to Gita, Nomi, and then yeah. Silakan kalau ada yang mau bertanya. So I think we still have 10 minutes maximum. Actually not, but I think if I say 5, it's not realistic, so it. Yeah, satu, anyone wants to have comments or response or too tired? Yeah.
I was actually just wondering, because we've been talking about Dramaturgy all day, and I was wondering whether there were dramaturgical suggestions or ways in which one could make the proposition of the subaltern somehow self-reflexive, because I think the problem is that when the subaltern also becomes as opaque as what it is responding to, then one falls into the trap of really going back into a kind of gender polarity. So I was wondering, how does one dramaturgically make reflectivity or reflection visible, and whether there is also a way in which one, in the way that one constructs performance, if you can think about how space itself can be reconfigured, because there is always this thing of the performer, and so the othering is already there in the way that a performance is constructed, especially in the proscenium. The performer, the audience, someone's in the dark, someone is lit, someone's higher, someone's lower, all those things are already sort of built into performance, and I was wondering whether as performers, that's one of the routes of sort of dramaturgically throwing up throwing up these questions again.
Mungkin berhubungan dari bagian yang saya lakukan gitu di saya kerjakan di layar story ada narasi tubuh yang mendialogkan antara energi maskulin dan juga feminin di situ sehingga ada semacam sehingga nanti menghasilkan nah, di situ ada maskulin dan juga ada feminin yang akan muncul pada tubuh si penari gitu. Selain itu juga ada juga narasi yang memang ada tarik menarik antara tubuh itu sendiri dan juga tubuh sosial yang juga terlihat di penunjukannya gitu, menjadi mereka akan dapat dirinya juga bisa sebenarnya seperti ini.
Thank you for that question. I was beginning to feel like Sisyphus, you know, I thought I had taken the boulder off the hill, but then the fact that a lot of questions are being asked about the movement, you know, our lived experiences rather than the dramaturgical process was making me feel like the boulder came down and I had to roll it up again. So thank you for that. I think one of the strategies that I was suggesting was not that the subaltern makes itself more legible, but the fact that the burden has to be shared by everyone, especially the mainstream, especially the privileged, especially the people whose identities are unmarked. And I think that is one of the ways in which we can unpack how these systems really work. Because the subaltern is already feeling that pressure. The subaltern is constantly under the pressure of revealing itself and dissecting or laying itself there for everyone to see. I think that burden has to be shared. And I think the one way to think about it is if privilege has to be democratized, then the burden of carrying the weight of those identities have to be democratized as well. And I think I would like to quote the Nigerian writer Avicii, who talks about the danger of the single narrative. I think the multiplicity of narratives around gender, I think that's really what I was suggesting as gender dramaturgy, something that's self-reflexive, something that's not the burden of only the subaltern to carry. And I think that I will stop doing gendered dramaturgy from now on. I would rather be cast as, you know, a Kafkaesque cockroach in a play rather than do this, because I think that the democratization is not happening. It's still the subaltern that's carrying the weight.
Kayaknya okay.
Yeah, just to say, I agree that new dramaturgies are needed. If transgender artists replicate their own oppression and, you know, through testimony, theater, and all of that, which was necessary historically, let's say maybe historically it was important to begin there. But I agree with you that the burden of defining identity, anyone's identity, is something that has to be shared. It has to be democratized, to use your word. And I think for that, yes, new dramaturgies are definitely needed. You know? So then who is going to create the new dramaturgies is the question. You know? know, is it going to come from transgender community alone, or even will the NGOs also unlearn what they think is correct or what they think is the politically necessary thing to do, you know? And I think the theater is an enormously rich space for multiplicity. So you can go on changing. You don't have to be one person or one identity. You can be any number of identities. I mean, that's the beauty of theater. It can be fun. You can crack up. You can do all kinds of things in the theater. There's no limit to the imagination. I agree with you. At the moment, there is a kind of, maybe it's a wrong word, false seriousness, a kind of seriousness that is taking over, coming out of pain and suffering, which is real, you know. But beyond the point, it's a trap. You know, it's a trap to get into that. And the more you are promiscuous on stage, the more you are playful on stage, the more you are irreverent on stage, I think that's when new dramaturgies will automatically mutate, you know. You don't have to be a cockroach. You know, the cockroach route is not necessary. But I think more promiscuity, that's the word I will use. That the imagination is promiscuous. The theatricality is promiscuous. You know? We don't have to be bound within any gender constraint. You know, that's the ultimate challenge. You know? How to fight for a particular identity and yet not be locked within that identity. I think Judith Butler was deeply aware of that.
Yeah, thank you very much. I welcome everyone to this presentation. Actually, we are out of running out of time, like more than 20 minutes. So I wouldn't close this session with conclusions or anything. It's just like, for me, it's very interesting to read questions or the established definition or interpretations about how we ourselves, everyone should perform our gender identity. I think I agree, it's not the, with Tamara, it's not the problem of only transgender or homosexual, it's everybody having the same problem on how we perform our gender and sexual identity. So I think this session works really well in terms of giving us lots of questions to be taught. And thank you very much for everyone, for Omul, G, and Tamara. Thank you very much. And also thank you for Brigitta and Naomi.